شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، إقرارا بربوبيته وإرغاما لمن جحد به وكفر. وأشهد أن سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم سيد الخلق والبشر، ما اتصلت عين بنظر أو سمعت أذن بخبر. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وعلى ذريته ومن والاه ومن تبعه إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما، وأرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه، واجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه، وادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين، وأخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى أنوار المعرفة والعلم، ومن وحول الشهوات إلى جنات القربى. Brothers and sisters, الحجاج was a ruthless leader. He dealt with things in basic bloodshed. Awards of Al-Hasan al-Basri, a well-known scholar from the second generation, about him reached him. And while he was in his governing palace, and these words reached him, he said, "I will teach this man a lesson. I will execute him in front of all of you. You can witness what I will do with him." So he called upon the swordsman, and they prepared the place of execution. At the same time, he sent a messenger to Al-Hasan al-Basri to come forward for a meeting. So Al-Hasan al-Basri went with nothing in mind. As he walked in and he saw the swordsman and the platform was set, he knew it was his time to be executed. Those who were sitting in that place, they noticed something. As soon as Al-Hasan al-Basri noticed that his death is imminent, he whispered something that no one could understand. And all of a sudden, Al-Hajjaj, who was destined to kill him, greeted him and welcomed him and made him sit next to him. And he granted him something to drink, something to eat, and they had a nice chat together. And he also gave him some perfume to put on. And he said to him, "You are the best person I've met. Thank you very much for your humble visit." And he escorted him all the way outside the palace. The swordsmen and the guards could not believe what they saw, and also the people were there. So they followed Al-Hasan al-Basri out and said to him, "What has happened? What is it that you have said that changed this man from one thing to another?" Al-Hasan al-Basri said, "I said, O Allah, you are my savior in hardships, and you are my companion in my loneliness. Make his anger, the energy and the heat of his anger, to come pleasant and cold as the fire where Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was cast, that you Allah Almighty change the heat of fire into something cold and safe upon him." These are the few words that he said that changed the whole surrounding. Another incident happened, but this time it is with Sa'id ibn Jubayr. Al-Hajjaj told him one day, "I am going to kill you." Sa'id ibn Jubayr said to him, "By Allah, if I know that you have my life in your hand, I would have worshipped you. But my life is in the hands of Allah Almighty. And if you try to kill me, I will die only when the day Allah commands that I will die. Yunus alayhi salam. You know the story when he was swallowed by the whale. And Allah has mentioned that in the Quran. In Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 88. فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَلَّا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِّ وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. In the meaning of it, and he called out within the darkness, there is no one but you, Allah subhanahu. Indeed, I have been a wrongdoer. And then Allah continued to say in the verse, so we responded to him and saved him from distress, and thus do we save the believers. Imagine that, Yunus, inside the whale that has swallowed him, what are the chances of survival in anyone in his case? Almost zero. He was inside the whale, in total darkness of the night, the darkness of the guts of the whale, the darkness of the deep ocean, the darkness of the night, and he called upon Allah sincerely and see what has happened to him. Nowadays, it is really strange to find out. People know about everything. And some people are happy because they practice and learn a foreign language, or you can speak several languages together. You ask that person, can you read a verse in the Quran? Then you discover he has difficulty in reading a single verse in the Quran. His energy went to learn a total different language, yet he did not focus on reading the Quran and understanding the Quran. You find people nowadays fluent. They have interest, whether it is politics, economics, sports, art, design, celebrity news, any type of news. You could sit together with them and enjoy a colorful discussion with a lot of energy and enthusiasm as you speak with these people. And whether it is politics, he's willing to talk for several hours regarding a certain matter, economics, social issues, you name it. Ask that person, and by the way, that person could be you. Ask that person, tell me about Allah Almighty. Go ahead, speak. What you will notice, he will start talking. But the amount of energy, the amount of excitement, the amount of things that he had himself, you know, the heat and, you know, the passion he had when he spoke to you about the sports or the soccer league or the European whatever, all of a sudden becomes something that is cold. The tone of his voice becomes extremely low. And when he used to speak about any subject, he could speak from today till next week. He has no problem. When you tell him to speak about Allah Almighty, all of a sudden his voice goes lower and lower and lower, and within 5 minutes he has nothing to say. And that person could be me or you. Do you wonder why this happens? It is simple. The reason why, because all of us, if we are interested in a subject matter, it would gain our attention. We would read about it. We would interact with it. And we would study it. And therefore, it becomes part of you, whether it's a hobby or a sport or whatever. The same principles are applied to knowing Allah Almighty. That is studying, interest, passion, and exposure and interactions about Allah Almighty. 1.6 billion with a B, strong Muslims worldwide, whether in schools, whether in colleges, whether in the villages, whether high in the mountains, or there are far away distant places in the seas. When you ask them about Allah Almighty, they probably know the commands of Allah, but do they know الله. العزة بن عبد السلام said it 750 years ago in a short statement, the key to what was going on. He said, knowing the names and the attributes of Allah Almighty, الأسماء الحسنى وصفاته العليا, is among the highest, most honorable and rewarding type of study. Studying and knowing the names and attributes of Allah Almighty is the most honorable and rewarding type of knowledge that a person should learn. And in a statement, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim also said, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim said, whoever he knows Allah by his names and his attributes, he would love Allah beyond any doubt whatsoever. Therefore, the key of the failure is the lack of Muslims about knowing about their Creator. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان يوم الدين. Let me give you an example. Every car you drive has a dashboard with all the gauges on it. And you will notice there are two gauges that move together most of the time. That is the speed and also the revolution per minute of the car itself. Likewise, I would give this as an example. The speed or the amount of the fear from Allah coordinates with the amount of your righteousness. They move, they increase together, and they decrease together. With that, as they increase, the amount of energy you have in yourself to obey Allah Almighty. So therefore, don't just be glad by saying La ilaha illallah, but test yourself, how much do you obey Allah Almighty? When you glorify Allah, when your glorification of Allah by studying the names and the attributes of Allah Almighty, the glorification of Allah increases. The obedience of Allah, your obedience of Allah increases. Your energy towards serving Allah increases. And your pleasure by worshipping Allah increases. Therefore, the foundation of our religion, of Islam, is knowing Allah, the one you worship, Allah Almighty. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one day, he found a piece of dates. One of the dates was on his bed. So he went to Aisha and he said to her, you know, I fear that this date could be among the dates of charity. Therefore, I am forbidden from eating it. Therefore, I'm not going to eat it. You can imagine the sense and the accuracy and the fear from Allah Almighty the Prophet Muhammad had with him. That reflection, you and I, by studying the names and the attributes of Allah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam, Al-Mu'min, Al-Muhayyim, people know it by words, they don't know what they are. The basic, as I told you, is studying each name and attribute of Allah. By knowing whom you worship, that will affect your life, affect your faith, affect your end. As I finish this khutbah, there is a homework. From now on, if you have a book or through the internet, study the names and the attributes of Allah. In YouTube, there are various lectures about the names and the attributes. Know your Creator. When you know your Creator, this excites the fear in yourself and the righteousness. And I also agreed with the gentleman who was selling the books. that inshallah next week all the books that are related to the names and the attributes of Allah are sold outside for you to study. I myself, I started it 2 weeks ago. I made it for myself as a daily. Each day I read only 4 pages. I have a book and I read every pages every day. Why? Because I don't want to finish the book quickly because I want the information to settle. I want the information to react with me. I want the information for me to be able to live with it a whole day till I move to the other attributes of Allah Almighty. I ask Allah Almighty, what I said is for us and not against us. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك لنا